At the end of 2013, we went to Malta to video its temples. And whilst on the island, we volunteered at an eco-friendly permaculture project and were introduced to the idea of going off-grid and living more harmoniously with nature. We saw growing your own food as a significant piece of the coming revolution, but couldn't see how people living in the cities would be persuaded to go green. For this reason, we were drawn to an intriguing project during our trip to South Africa.
I saw something interesting in a YouTube clip about somebody who had converted a pool into a greenhouse. Mm. And I've been sitting with this great big 148,000 litre gaping hole. Far too expensive to fill up, lots of chemicals, really just not good for the environment. So I thought, well, let's see if we can roof it over. So that's exactly what we've done. You'll see, again, lots of tyres. I really like using tyres as a building material. Very, very abundant as waste. And you can see lots of things planted in dog food bags and in cans and anything that can really be repurposed rather than end up in landfills. So let me take you for a swim.
And that's, I mean, it's such a good material to have because it's strong, right?
It's strong. The jury is out on whether it off-gasses or not. Some people are hesitant to do root crops in it, for example, just in case there's still sort of rubber particles and chemicals that off-gas. Mm. But the jury is pretty much out on that one. There's no actual decision. It depends on who you read as to which way you swing. Right. So you can see it's quite a jungle in here. I showed you some maroch out in the front garden, which was about this high. That was planted at the same time as this maroch that is now busy trying to go through the roof of the greenhouse.
Wow, so the other one's this big and that one is that huge.
So, you can see there's a hell of a lot happening here. It looks a little bit jungle-like. Lots of tomatoes. I would say I've probably got about 20 different things growing in just this corner. It's quite amazing what you can actually grow in a small area. And that's part of what we're trying to show here. You don't need a hell of a lot of space. To be able to grow stuff on, you know, that is useful for you. So there's cucumbers, there's mint, there's fennel, tomatoes, curry bush, if you want to try that silvery one. If you smell that one, you'll actually smell why they call it a curry bush.
All right.
It actually does smell of curry. This is a bronze fennel, there's basil, there's mints here, kale. You'll see the sweet peas are climbing up the wall on netting that is used to secure boxes of tomatoes on pallets so they don't fall off.
Right.
I get that from my fruit and veg.
Where did you learn all this stuff?
Ask. I go into any environment and I say, what waste do you have in your industry or in your shop? And then I see how I can use it. I look at a material and I think we can't possibly just throw that away.
Right.
We've got to be able to use this somehow.
So you've got tires, I guess you reuse wood a lot.
Beds over here on the right, again, along that Hügelkultur method, these are reused pallets that we've actually just braced against the poles. And what we've done behind there is we've filled it up with logs and the various layers of the Hügelkultur again.
Right.
The logs I get from anybody in the neighborhood that's actually trying to chopping down a tree, also it'll just go to landfill.
Right.
So if I see somebody chopping down a tree, then I'll say, look, you know, please, do you mind if I take the waste off your hands?
Right. And so I guess... Water bottles?
Water bottles, we've cut them open. There's a bit of beetroot and stuff growing in here. There's some yellow dock. This was a tray, the polystyrene trays are used in the growing industry. Mm. It's a friend of ours who had a project. He's got them lying around. We traded them and he's going to get seedlings from us and we're using his seed trays.
Right.
So it kind of ties in with the other things that I'm trying to do, which is trying to move sort of out of the sort of fiat currency system to try and work on bartering and trading. What have you got that I find useful and what can I do to enrich your life? So the strawberry behind you is also a trade. I did some consulting for somebody on a recycling project, and they gave me these huge bags of strawberries. Okay, eat the big one and see if it tastes better than what you get.
Okay.
And then here we've got a nice silver, I think it's a silver bark or a silver stem berry.
Holy shit.
I think that's the reaction I get with a lot of you. Oh my word, is that what it's supposed to taste like? Or is this one just unripe and that sour?
Wow, that's amazing. No, it's not sour. It's It's more, well, it's slightly sour, but it's the strength of the flavour. Yeah. Like the ones back in England, that you almost, it's like it's been watered down.
Were my eyes deceiving me, or did I see a shower in the garden over there?
You did indeed see a shower. You probably saw yourself in the shower as well. Okay, on the way to the shower, I just wanted to show you this. You can see a whole bunch of little baby banana trees there, okay. Which I've got potted in the dog food bags. It's just that if anybody wants to trade or wants one, then they're easily transportable. And those are babies from the trees that my neighbor's gardener brought me. This one I find very interesting. This is sugarcane, and this for me is that learning curve that I was talking about. I'm learning how to grow a lot of these things, and I'm working on my plant knowledge. Somebody gave me a stick of sugarcane. I would never have known that you actually have to bury it under the ground instead of just stick it upright like anything else, because it's a grass. So the sugarcane starts growing. You see it, there's regular nodes. It starts growing out of those individual nodes. So for me, that's a learning curve. Yeah. And now it's something I've learned and I can teach it.
Right.
So here you see the recycled materials again. Paths made from the bricks that I got from a construction site. The bottles, the wine bottles, I'm in the wine industry, so I have a lot of wine bottles. And you'll see they make great bed edgings. Lots of other interesting stuff here. These willow trees are planted from little sticks that I got from a florist, and they just started growing. It was decor and it started growing when I watered it. So,
wow, that's amazing.
I don't think we really see things, you know, as being natural in plants and being able to still grow and support life. So it's a different way of looking at things.
It's almost like half garden, half experiment.
It's a colossal experiment. It's a colossal experiment.
Yeah, right.
Right, this is where we're getting through to the berry patch. You'll see there's five or six different kinds of berries in there. You see the beds are lined with old tile, which we get from one of our big tile manufacturers. And they literally discard it. As soon as it's all damaged or leftovers, they can't actually sell it anymore. So it goes into landfill. They contacted me and they asked, would I like to use it for my mosaic projects, for my community project and skills development. So here I am, and I see where I can use it. I used the tile in the mosaics you saw in the studio. I used it to tile the floor in the cottage. We use it around the garden. And at the very least, we can break it up and we can use it for drainage. So at least it's not going into landfill. Here's the pecan tree. You can see there's still some young pecan nuts, or they're just about to come on here. It's growing a little bit skew, but we're getting there. So over here, we're starting with the wild cherry.
So what's this one?
This is the tree tomato.
Ah, okay.
And this is the wild cherry. You can see they're growing quite nicely.
A lot of plants all over the place.
That's the one. On the way down to the shower, let's see if we can show you the compost heap. Composting is a very important part of trying to garden. It's a typical sort of three-section system, with one section where things are being added. So it's everything from kitchen waste to garden waste, to my neighbor's garden waste as well, because I don't have that much green waste here. One section of it is actually just sitting there cooking, turning into compost. Right. And the other one is the one that we're actually busy using. So we sift it to get it a little bit finer.
So it's like storage, this is where the action's happening, this is where you take from.
Pretty much, yeah. Right. So it's good because it takes a bit of time for you know, stuff to turn into compost.
Yeah,
so that way you've always got some to use.
Well, like I said, this is the food for the plants, right?
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. And there you can see more bottles. We don't lack for raw material.
So how many, you can get skips and skips of the tiles, right?
I'd say from the one CTM that I work with, three skips a week.
Three skips a week?
From one of the CTMs.
Wow.
Okay, so here's the beginnings of the volunteer bathroom. We found the shower tray lying by the side of the road. Somebody discarded it. We've dug a fence drain underneath here so that the water can go straight to the roots of the fig tree behind you.
Okay.
Filled it up with rubble from a construction site. They came and loaded it up. And the mirror that you can see in the shower, we've got from a glass shop up the road. They just collect all their discarded bits and we use it to make into something pretty.
Wow, that's great. So all the water is reused then?
It's reused. It goes into the fridge drain and the roots of the fig tree are here. It's important for a fig tree to get water at its roots, not necessarily in through the soil. And you can see it's going to be
yeah, so you're really trying to get as many uses as possible out of everything.
That's basically one of the permaculture projects, that everything that you use should have two or three different applications.
Yeah.
Maybe a tree should throw shade, and it provides nutrients to the soil, and it provides fruit, and so every aspect of what you put in your design should have two or three different applications.
Yeah, so it really is growing by design, isn't it?
Very much so. So on this side, a little bit more lemon verbena, curry plant, feverfew, very good for headaches. Mm-hmm. There's some rhubarb, there's beans, there's radishes going to seed. There's the two original bananas that my neighbor's gardener brought.
Right.
And then here I've got some cassava growing, which I'm very proud of, because cassava is not a common plant here in South Africa, but it's a staple in the rest of Africa. Mm-hmm. And my gardener brought some back when he went on holiday home to Malawi. and he brought a couple of sticks of cassava back for me. Right. And it really gives me the idea that I'm succeeding in my message to people to say, come and join us here, come and get involved with what we're doing. He's really buying into what I'm doing. Mm. So I'm very chuffed with that. From that, berries, there's a grenadilla there, artichoke, chamomile, and you see the back of the bottle wall with all the necks sticking out.
Yeah.
Normally you'd make the bottle wall deeper with two bottoms on either side, but I've kept the necks sticking out so that the beans can climb up the necks of the bottles. So that I don't have to actually make. And it looks great too.
It's like walking around, there's lots of artwork basically. It's like an art piece as well.
No need not to make it pretty. You can make it pretty, of course, even though it's useful.
I guess Natanya comes in with that as well. Okay.
Yep, she gets involved with that as well. She's done the mural there by the storeroom, the one of the tribals and the fairies. Mm-hmm. And we've got a lot of plans for the rest of it. We get involved, we do open days with our crafts. So the students actually get involved and they make part of what we do here. It's not just us doing it. So the volunteers get involved. The mirrors here were pretty much done by three different volunteers, four different volunteers. Mm. I had a German couple in here that came through woofing. And then I had a young South African guy here, he's a tiler. He came in through Workaway. And then I had an English girl, Anna Marie. She came in through HelpX. So there's different online volunteering organizations where hosts can say, I need help, this is what I'm doing, would you like to get involved in my project? And the volunteers say, okay, I would like to spend 3 weeks in South Africa, can I come and spend some time with you? So they live with South African or local families, they learn a little bit about what we're trying to do here, and you get the advantage of being able to put them to work for a couple of hours every day.
Well, that's great, it takes out the need for currency, right? It's kind of a bartering.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Talents and time, and that's how we came here.
Absolutely, it works for me, and I'm very enjoying it.
There's more out front, right? There's another garden in the front?
There's another garden in the front. It never ends.
How many types of plant do you grow?
When last I checked, we've got about 150 different types of things, but we're planting a lot of seeds at the moment, so probably looking at about 200 different varieties of things.
Wow.
So for me, it's partly about seed saving, it's partly about a learning curve, trying to figure out which plant works well where. So what have we got here? There's celery, I think that's a butternut. Pomegranate trees, that's angelica, there's corn, strawberries, peppers, cotton lavender, which is really good for your compost heap, there's nasturtiums, and it's all just in one bed. And to see what works together, we try to practice a little bit of companion planting. Mm. Don't always get it right. We'll see, there's some berries, there's a dragon fruit, there's quince tree, there's loads of stuff here.
So they're all giving back to the kind of the ecosystem in a way, right?
They are. For example, there's a couple of plants here that you chop and drop. By the time they've grown, you just cut them and you let them fall on the soil, and it integrates and it starts then forming soil again. There's some compost activators like borage, for example, mm-hmm. is specifically good at activating compost. Cotton lavender, like I said, is very good for compost as well.
Again, we continue with just tons of different plants, right?
Yep, absolutely. It's rocket.
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 Lettuce.
Eat it.
That's it.
Yeah, exactly. No, it's a nice spicy, peppery kind of lettuce. There's some more chilies. This is yarrow. It's a very good medicinal plant to make sort of wound dressings with. What else is there? There's spinach. There's a milk thistle, very good for hangovers. It's very good liver tonic, milk thistle.
Right.
What else is some?
You've just got 150 of plants that just give you food and give you medicinal benefits.
Yep.
And you keep animals as well, right?
Yeah, we do. Because I'm in an urban environment, there's not a lot of animal manure, so I started keeping some chickens.
Mm.
And because I'm involved in animal rescue, I ended up rescuing battery chickens. So I've got a bunch of spent hens that are living out their last years here. We rescue them. They look like sad, bedraggled little creatures by the time they come. But they liven themselves up. So.
And then there's the dogs, and then you've got the birds.
There's dogs, there's wolves. Yeah, I've got two Canadian timber wolves rescued.
And not forgetting the worms.
The worms, yeah, the worms can't really be called rescues, I suppose. Yeah, this is the worm farm. Permaculture is a very good way of getting nutrients into the soil, and we put our food waste in here. This is actually dried eggshell from the chickens,
mm-hmm.
And you'll see underneath the really nice rich soil. There you go, you see some of the little critters starting to go.
Right.
And underneath here you'll see the buckets with what we call the worm wee. because the liquid that actually seeps down through the soil is actually very, very rich fertilizer.
Right.
So we use that again on the
So you're keeping worms to basically create a kind of fertilizer.
It's exactly what it is. Vermicast and worm, we are very, very good fertilizers.
Really?
So again, it's a way of utilizing waste.
Yeah.
That's possibly more efficient than going into compost. I've got a big compost heap there as well.
Mm.
It's just a different set of nutrients that it puts into the soil. So this is a fruit tree. Some form of stone fruit. And here we've got a bit of a nursery for baby trees. This is fig trees, there's some gooseberries, there's some pomegranate trees.
And you've got plants outside?
We've got plants outside. Again, that's to try and see if we can get the community involved in what we're doing. So this is part of my trying to get the message across to people that actually we're trying to do sort of useful and edible stuff here. So again, I've used the tires as the waste material just to keep all the soil in a little bit, make it look a little bit pretty. And I've got all sorts of useful things growing here. You can see some tomatoes, which I must admit I did not plant myself. They're gratuitous tomatoes, they grow out of the compost. It's very hard to kill a tomato.
Oh, really?
You can see there's some fruit happening on already. There's wild garlic here, again, some more of the speckworm. There's corn, there's Jerusalem artichokes, there's some calabashes growing in here.
So all of this outside of your house is basically for the community to just
for anybody to come and help themselves, to come and take if they need it.
And in the process you get to educate them about what these things are, right?
Yeah. So what we're trying to do with the corn is, you'll see we've just planted beans at the bottom there.
Mm.
As the corn actually provides strength for the beans to climb up.
Okay.
And the squashes and butternuts and pumpkins actually keep the weeds out at the bottom. So you can plant three different types of crops in one place.
And they help each other.
And they help each other and you get three different types of crops out of it. It's called three sisters planting, if I recall correctly.
What are you doing here exactly? You're planting potatoes then, basically.
Yeah, I got a couple of sweet potatoes. We get them growing in a drawer in the kitchen, so they start sprouting. And you just need to pop them in the ground. They are reaching up, so usually the leaves reach for the light. So out of this potato, there's potentially 1, 2, 3, 4, at least 5 different plants could evolve out of one potato.
Right.
Yeah, leave it in the oven drawer for a few weeks and you should have this result.
Mm.
And then go pop it in the ground.
So tell us how you fit into this whole project.
Well, I stay in the house with Hanukkah and I trade for the accommodation. I help in the garden and sometimes help training the workers, showing them what to do,
mm-hmm.
teaching them about different plants and their uses, how to grow them.
So the art is a hobby? Or?
The art used to be a way of life for me, just to be something I did every day. It became a way of income. But now it is a way of also utilizing everything around me to create a beautiful home environment for
right.
myself one day. Yeah. So I try and take things like waste from the garden and I can recycle it, turn it into art pieces.
Mm.
And a lot of awesome things with bamboo, made wind chimes.
Yeah.
And then you can look at these calabash pods. They grow in all different shapes and sizes. So I've painted them. This one is the flow of a triangle. So it goes all the way around. There's no dead end. That is an incense holder.
Yeah.
The idea is that your incense goes into the hole there.
Mm.
And you light it and the ash falls into the slots, into the seed pod. Yeah, I got bird feeders that I'm working on. Also made out of these calabashes.
Hmm.
So for me, it's not really that you need to earn money to survive, but like you could go into dumpsters and scratch things out, keep yourself busy, make something awesome for your own space, or sell it for money if you really think you need money.
Hmm.
But you don't.
No.
And that's the beauty of it.
Just a couple of questions, really. I would like to know how this all started and why, really?
I think I've been involved and interested in different aspects of sustainable living for a long time. And I've always grown things since I was very young. So those kind of things are very much part and parcel of each other. I'm interested in going off-grid, in alternative energy sources, in alternative currencies, anything that doesn't slot into the mainstream, what we refer to as the default world. So that's kind of how I got involved here. I want to show people that you can actually work on your sustainable thinking and strategies in an urban, suburban type of environment. You don't have to go out to a farm to be able to grow things. You can have fresh, tasty, nutritional stuff growing in your own garden on a small space. You don't actually have to go out and be a farmer in order to get back that connection with seasons and with land.
I mean, you say you have a lot of space here, but that doesn't necessarily mean if you only had a small space that you can't do this, right?
That's the
whole
point.
I mean, you're forming a kind of community here. And
that's part of what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to get, let's say, the pedestrians in my community involved so long, because they can see what I'm doing. They go past a little slower than the people in cars. Mm. But I'm already starting to find people that live down the road say, oh, I see you have corn growing. I have some seedlings. Would you like to swap?
So you plan to use the kind of exchange barter system for the future, I guess, to help you build the project up? Or what are your plans for the future?
Lots of plans. You see, there's lots of things that I want to do, and that's what I want to use my volunteers for. I'm not going to wait until I have a perfect volunteer setup until I get volunteers, and I'm going to use my volunteers, and they will learn through helping with the projects what it's all about. Mm-hmm. For me, it ties in with my activities through CES, the Community Exchange Services, or Community Exchange Systems. I'm a very active part of the Johannesburg Talent Exchange, which is an alternative currency. It's a record-keeping system for barter transactions. So I'm very excited about that. And this is the way, the volunteering is a way of tying in with CES and with things like time banking and perma credits, which is all over the world. CES is at the moment, I think, it's over 60 countries. Wow. So it's an international exchange mechanism. Where people can exchange their goods and their items and their time and their learning, their teaching for a currency, for something which they can then exchange for other items in the exchange internationally.
Yeah, and it takes away the power from all the big corporations, right?
It decentralizes it. Yeah,
we don't need money.
You don't technically need money. I think while you have the system, you need to work within it a bit. I don't think you'll ever be able to get 100% of your personal economy done with those alternative currencies, because it's unlikely that the banks and the electricity providers and the big corporates are going to be accepting talents anytime soon.
No.
But we can only strive, and the more we focus on creating local communities, the less necessary those big things are going to become.
Yeah.
So for me, that is what's important, is creating community. Mm-hmm. And the community exchange systems do exactly that, because I'm more interested in trading for spinach with my neighbor than I am to go to a big sort of superstore and buy the spinach there. I don't know where it's come from, I don't know who's farmed it, I don't know what pesticides are on it. I would rather know that something is grown locally, it doesn't have a big carbon footprint, and it's done by somebody that I can say hello to in the street.
Mm-hmm.
That for me is important about the exchange systems. It's creating community. It's bringing it a little bit closer, and it's decentralizing out of the big corporates, the big cities.
Growing your own food has many advantages, especially in a day and age where the prices of food are high and the quality of that food is low. You can grow healthy food and medicinal plants, and if we all chipped in and formed communities, we could start something quite revolutionary for both individuals and for humanity. City food production is not a new thing. There is a lot of information online and some great ideas. For example, Lola Hulbein details in her book One Magic Square how to create a productive food garden in just a simple square meter using any space available, even balconies. She states it is possible to grow staggering amounts of food in just a small plot, and she should know, having grown up in Holland during World War II, where she was forced to practice self-sufficiency in order to survive. And she was not the only one. In the UK during the Second World War, this revolutionary act was tried and tested with the Dig for Victory campaign, which encouraged people to transform gardens, parks and sports pitches into allotments to grow vegetables. The British government knew the people could be starved out by a sea blockade, and the campaign is now deemed as a hugely significant cog in the British war machine. So with an estimated 25 million houses and gardens in the UK alone, imagine how much food we could produce worldwide if we all started to do a little growing.
Talking about the rich folks, the poor create the rich oaks, and only late breastfed folks.